Okay, definition time. General idea: emotion is a mind and body's integrated response to a stimulus of some kind. Emotions involve physiological arousal, expressive behaviors, and conscious experience. These can be short flashes or long lingering responses, and they can be very clear or very confusing. Say you're walking home at night and you hear footsteps behind you. Physiological arousal occurs in the form of your heart pounding. Your expressive behaviors could be like quickening your pace or moving toward a streetlight, and your conscious experience may include thinking, oh, I'm gonna get mugged now? Is this like a werewolf behind me? Feeling, you know, fear and panic. We know those three pieces are there, but psychologists are still puzzling out exactly how they fit together. How do thinking and feeling interact? Which one comes first? And do these bodily reactions, the pounding heart, the need to pee, the sweaty palms, come as a result of the thought I'm scared, or did my tweaking out body trigger the thought in my brain? Our emotions represent and construct a big part of who we are. Think of how boring we would be, how boring the world would be without joy, embarrassment, heartache, or fear. What would motivate us to make decisions, be cautious or bold, or strive to understand each other? What would keep our humanity intact? Where would punk rock come from? No doubt, we need our emotions. But how do they work? Well, like apparently everything in psychology, there are a few different theories. In the late 1800s, pioneering American psychologist William James suggested that our feelings follow our bodily reactions to external situations. That, for example, you feel sad because you are crying, or you're scared because you're shaken like a leaf. This idea was also proposed by Danish psychologist Carl Lange, and so this concept that physiological arousal precedes emotion is called the James-Lange theory. But American physiologist Walter Cannon wasn't feeling it. He thought that too many of the body's reactions were too similar. A racing heart, fluttering stomach, and sweaty hands could be attributed to passion, fear, excitement, or anger, so how could they cause such different emotions? His colleague Philip Bard agreed, concluding that bodily responses and emotions occur separately but simultaneously. And this idea is the base of the Cannon-Bard theory of emotion. In other words, a racing heart doesn't cause fear, nor does the feeling of fear result in a racing heart. Rather, both things just happen together. Today, most psychologists agree that our emotions are also tangled up with our cognition. Whether or not we're afraid of a dog on the sidewalk depends a lot on whether we're interpreting the animal's behavior as threatening or friendly, and probably also what our personal history with dogs is. In the 1960s, American psychologists Stanley Schachter and Jerome Singer interpreted this idea that cognition can define emotion into what they called their two-factor theory. They believe that to experience emotion, you must both feel physiological arousal and cognitively label that arousal. Fear arousal can be thought of as activation or stress or even energy, an increase in reactivity or wakefulness that primes us for some kind of action. So sometimes arousal can spill over from one event to the next. Say you just watched a heated soccer match and you're all revved up and someone looks at you funny. Suddenly, you might label that lingering arousal as anger. And the next thing you know, the whole stadium is one big rioting aggro chain reaction. Schachter and Singer examined this so-called spillover effect with an experiment that involved an unusual combination of college guys and drugs. First, they injected a bunch of college guys with the hormone epinephrine. This is basically adrenaline, and as you yourself have probably experienced, it induces a level of physiological activation that can go any number of ways emotionally. But then they threw a curveball. Some of the subjects were told to expect symptoms of feeling all revved up, while others were told the injection wouldn't produce any effects at all. Then, after being injected, each subject was left in a waiting room, and with them in the room was an actor, pretending to wait as well, and acting either all jerky and irritated or super happy and euphoric. So the dude's just sitting there, jacked up on this hormone, and his heart is racing, and his cheeks are all flushed. And in the case where the subject was told not to expect any effects, the study found that the guy would actually adopt the emotion of the actor in the room, becoming happy or testy, depending on how the person was acting. His body was having a physiological response to the hormone, but he ended up effectively deciding which emotion he was feeling. But if the subject had been told that the injection would make him feel all pumped up, he'd actually report very little emotion, just because he was blaming that racing heart and flushed face on the drug, not a particular state of mind. So in terms of the two-factor theory, the cause of physiological arousal had to be identified before before a person could feel and label the response as a particular emotion.
To Schachter, Singer, and their disciples, this meant that arousal spurs emotion, but cognition directs it.
And yet, some researchers, like Polish-born American psychologist Robert Zients, contend that all emotions are the result of just putting a name to our arousal. He suggests that many of our emotional reactions occur separately or even before our cognition kicks in. If you hear a sudden crash outside your window, you'll automatically react with a jolt before your brain has the chance to think, gee, what was that crazy noise? Should I feel startled? This is in part because when it comes to emotions, it's thought that our brains process sensory input by two different kinds of routes, top-down or bottom-up approaches, and neuroscientists can actually chart these two pathways in action. Some bigger, more complex feelings like love and hatred take what we call the high road. Say you read a love letter from your sweetie. You can pin that mushy feeling in your heart to the sensory stimulus of reading, traveling from your eyes all the way through your thalamus to your brain's cortex. There it can be analyzed by means of your cognitive process, perhaps consciously, perhaps implicitly, and labeled with, like, no, oh, it's so sweet, at which point it heads to your limbic system, the central brain region that drives emotion, motivation, and at that point, you respond with all the warm fuzzies. Other emotions, like simple likes, aversions, and fears, don't have to involve actual thinking and take a sort of low-road neural path, like that crash outside or a baseball flying at your head. Such jump-out-of-your-chair stimuli bypass the cortex and zip right from the ear or the eye to the amygdala in the limbic system. It's a knee-jerk reaction that allows us to react quickly, often in the face of potential danger. In other words, that slower high-road cortex route allows thinking about feeling, while the quick, low-road shortcut allows instant emotional reaction. The stomach flip that happens when you see your ex, or the 10,000 pee breaks you gotta take before you give a speech, or your heart racing after a really good kiss, it's hard to argue with the fact that we often feel emotions with our bodies as much as with our brains. And you can thank your autonomic nervous system the next time you're freaking out or trying to calm yourself down. Sympathetic division is what arouses you in a crisis. It makes you hyper-aware, makes your heart rate and breathing increase, spikes your blood sugar for extra energy, all that fun stuff. It's like a pit crew readying you for action. And once it's done its job and the danger has passed, the parasympathetic division steps in and talks you back down from the edge, slowing down your heart and breathing rates and shutting off those stress hormones, generally rubbing your back and being all, everything's gonna be okay, baby. What you need is the right degree of arousal for the situation. For example, if you're navigating through fast-moving traffic in an unfamiliar city, you'll want to hit the sweet spot of optimal arousal that allows you to focus your attention without either freaking out or getting all mellow and sleepy. Like we said before, there's a lot of overlap in the symptoms of different emotions. How do we actually feel all these feels, and how many different emotions are there? Back in the 1970s, American psychologist Carol Izard identified 10 distinct basic human emotions present from infancy on. They are joy, surprise, sadness, anger, disgust, contempt, shame, fear, guilt, and interest or excitement. Others have since suggested that pride should be added to that list, and still others believe that love should be classified as a basic emotion as well, but Izard has argued that these and other emotions are just familiar combinations of the classic 10. Today, some psychologists describe our emotional experiences using a two-dimensional model. The idea there is that any of the emotions you might feel while, like, reading Harry Potter or something, are expressed on a spectrum, and as a combination of valence, roughly speaking good or bad, and arousal, excited or not excited, basically. So if you're feeling both really excited and super positive when Harry finally bested Voldemort, you could say you were elated. On the other hand, if you're at that part in Deathly Hallows when Harry, Ron, and Hermione are just sort of wandering around on the lam in a heavy mood, maybe your emotions fell more on the opposite side of the spectrum. In this instance, feeling depressed might be a combination of negative emotion and lack of excitement. So potentially every emotion can fall in degrees on this two-dimensional scale. Like being terrified means you're more frightened than if you're just scared, just as being enraged is a more extreme form of anger than simply being mad. These polarities, positive versus negative, high arousal versus low arousal, affect our psychological states and therefore our bodies as well, because you'll remember that what is psychological is ultimately biological. And when it comes to the physical effects of our emotions, it pretty much goes the way you might expect. expect. Happiness is healthful, while chronic anger or depression makes us vulnerable to all kinds of problems with health and well-being. The good news is that if we're angry or sad, we often overestimate the duration of our bad moods and underestimate our capacity to adapt and bounce back from traumas, even if things feel hopeless, depressing, or stressful in the thick of it. And we've all experienced stress before, sometimes on a daily or even hourly basis. Much like anger or joy, stress can slowly build and simmer, or it can strike suddenly and with great intensity. And yeah, stress, certainly the chronic or extreme type, can be bad for your health, but defining stress is trickier than you might think. Psychologists would define stress as the process by which we perceive and respond to certain events, or stressors, that we view as challenging or threatening. In other words, stress isn't technically an emotion, it's more of a reaction to a disturbing or disruptive stimulus. And our reactions stem in part from our appraisal of that stimulus. A person can either roll with or get worked up about a missed flight, an increased workload, or a strange thump in the house. These external stressors typically fall into three main categories: catastrophes, or unpredictable large-scale events like war, natural disasters, and terrorist attacks; significant life changes, things like moving, having a child, losing or getting a job, or the death of a loved one; and then just everyday inconveniences like getting caught in traffic, running late, or feuding with your roommates. Any of these stressful events, big or small, even the good things, can fire up your sympathetic nervous system and trigger that old fight-or-flight response. In this way, it's important to understand that stress is ultimately natural. You experience it for a reason, and a bit of short-lived stress can actually be a good thing. It can make you active and alert when you need to be. Like, an upcoming chemistry test might be stressing you out, but that might help you find focus so you can dominate that thing. And in your body, moderate stress can kick the immune system into action to do things like heal wounds and fight infections. It does this by triggering the release of stress hormones like adrenaline and cortisol. These chemical messengers are what get your organ systems to respond the way you need them to when you're getting charged by a bear, or focusing really hard on the gas law for your chemistry test. But they're also why chronic stress can really wreck a body and mind.